Well, I was born in Pyrmont, but I don't seem to remember Pyrmont first. I remember Kittery, Maine first. Because that was really the first time I was alone, so to speak, in playing and finding things to do. And when that happened, I was able to become friends with my mind for the first time. And when the seagulls weren't there, they flew again in my mind. And in the morning, when I heard them crying and looking for food, that struck me as voices that they had, that they were using. And when I went out to play, and there weren't other people to play with, I got used to playing with rocks and stones and with the wind and looking at leaves on trees. So I learned very early to go in my own mind and live in there and have things move in there the same way they did out in life. And even more important than that, move in ways that I wanted to make them move. So it was like a world of things that I had to, that I could use to play with and to live with, and they became very real. I was sent up there because I was very ill. About 3 months old, I caught pneumonia. And in those days, you really didn't live from that. And I was up there, and between my mother and father and my aunt and uncle up there, I was nursed back to health, kind of thing. I'm the oldest of four. I have a brother and two sisters. My job always was to share everything I had with them. And my brother grew a lot. I didn't. He became captain of the football team, and it was very powerful and very strong. My sisters were very pretty, and they were readily accepted. I was too, because well, in school I could think well and play the piano. They didn't let me play the piano too much in school, of course. The janitor was always chasing me away from the piano. And strangely, all of this made me want to do it even more, because I had this dream in my mind that you always have to suffer to do something. You have to wake up in the middle of the night and secretly get your pencil out and keep your head under the covers and write. And it ended up being that. My piano teacher was Ann Dodge, whose husband was the editor of Downbeat magazine at that time. And she taught me jazz theory and classical piano. Then, along with that, I studied with Johnny Mahegan, more jazz theory and piano. Then Johnny brought me over to Teddy Wilson. So I had three piano teachers. Classical music crept in a little later. That started getting in there when I was about 13 or so. But in piano playing. But the classical music was always there in terms of the score reading and the theory. That was always classical from the very beginning. Fortunately, the jazz theory was mixed in with it.
So from the beginning, you've had a double life in music
Yes.
from the beginning.
Yes, and it's very interesting how that affected things.
Do you feel it comes from the same source? Your interest in love of jazz and of classical music?
Definitely. There
Yeah.
was never a separation in my mind, but outside in the world, there was
In the
this
outside world, right.
big separation. There was a time to do one thing and time to do the other thing, and you could not get the two things to mix. For example, when I was playing jazz, it was the club owners or the section of town that it was in. Or when I was in school, it was the way of that the teachers had of looking at certain kinds of music. If certain music was allowed in, certain music was not allowed in. In the church, it was the same way. So music was held hostage by all these different factions going along. And then I was told right outright that you don't play that kind of music, you play that kind of music. By certain people, when I was in with other people, they would say the other way around. When I was in the army, one person came to me once and said, why are you playing that music? Why don't you play your own? And I was simply playing a piece by Cole Porter, and this man wanted me to play St. Louis Blues. So there was just that, always that slight difference in it. It didn't make that much difference to me, because somehow I always regarded all music as just being playing music. And I saw it as a game that others were playing with the music, but as I came to realize it's a very serious game that they were doing with it. And it did cause a kind of a break in myself from my classical training over to my jazz playing and performing. And it wasn't until, really, in the writing of Engrams, that the two things actually did come together. Now, after all these years later, successfully, I know it was a success, but that's what was happening then. The two sides were being put back together again the way they were when I was first born. Engrams was written after, around the same time that I had visited a school in upstate New York, St. Lawrence University. And I had been asked to give a lecture at that school. And I did give that lecture, and I became lost in the lecture. Instead of it lasting 45 minutes, it went on for nearly 2 hours. The classes changed around me, and I had no idea this was going on. And I found that I was really talking about this separation between my jazz world and my classical world, and how these two things were living, going down two separate roads. And I was feeling that this was the condition of my life. I was not saying that it's about time for them to get together. I had no such thought. I was just noticing this peculiar fact of life. When I came back to New York, I began working on Engrams. And the piece was written within about the first 3 or 4 days of working on it. And then the rewrites happened in the next 3 or 4 days. So I would say the piece took about 1 week to write. But during that time, a very interesting thing happened. For the first time, I felt free and able to use the jazz things comfortably in the composition without worrying or feeling guilty or any of that. It was all gone. And my feeling for the jazz section went immediately over into my friend Cecil Taylor and his way of looking at jazz and at music, because I'd felt that way about it my whole life. And the use of the row in writing the piece lended itself beautifully to that kind of angular, boppish kind of way of writing. And it was a perfect match between the two ways of writing. I started with a row on Engrams and proceeded to construct it according to the row all the way through. But then when I went back, that's when all of the other things began to happen. Little bits of diatonic things began creeping back into it. Not as they were going to be diatonic, but in terms of my ear. My ear started hearing melodically. It started hearing some scale passages in there. And I knew that I wasn't going to ever have a scale passage as long as I was writing strictly with a row. So I departed from the row long enough to put some scale passages in and have my melodic sense be appeased. I called them aberrations at that point. Then when I used scale passages in terms of my jazz things, the scale passages came out very, very much in the manner of the bebop kind of thing, and the Cecil Taylor way of thinking about it.
Well, you have a lot of music in your catalog that is quite explicitly based on black subjects and black heritage. Do you feel that late 60s civil rights movement made you more aware of putting that emphasis in your music, or was that something that just came naturally to you, you wanted to do?
It was something I wanted to do. I don't think that what was going on in the 60s like that affected me at all in that way. I've always been an observer. Everywhere I am observing and sensing like that. So when I grew up the way I did, watching my grandmother do what she was doing, or going to church services and having to sit on that row between those two big, heavy black sisters, the deaconesses, and have them wave their fans, fluttering like little hummingbirds' wings, and rocking back and forth on the heel and toe, and having the whole bench just go up and down and up and down, and hearing that rhythm go that way, how could you not write about that? Then other times on Sunday night, the word would go around that a quartet was coming to town. And we'd go through the woods with lanterns to get to that little church. There's no more than maybe 35 or 40 people there. And the quartet would walk in and stand up in front and tune up. They'd just hum and tune and sing songs that I still haven't heard today. Old Blind Boniface Stood by the Way, or Was the Last Month in the Year When My Savior Was Born. I haven't heard these songs since that day. So when it came time for me to write that little piece, Honey Brown, using the old-fashioned gospel quartet, it came from what I grew up with. And believe me, I didn't think of those people as being black. I didn't even see the color. I just heard the music. And when I was sitting in that church between those sisters like that, I didn't see the black. I saw rich brown. And I smell the perfume, and I smell the dough rising from the rolls they cooked that morning before they came to church. That's what I smell. And that's what I saw. And when I was sitting beside the man, I saw the muscle in his hands, and I saw that scraggly look in his face of great strength, like if the car broke, he could lift the thing up with one hand, probably. But I didn't see black. I didn't see that at all. I saw strength, and I saw ability to handle life and to go on and to do the right thing. That's what I saw.